Sarah is not only my niece, but also my godchild. So she is basically half my age and equally Boston. So I hand over to her as MC, but also would like to use this opportunity to say a huge, huge thank you to this lovely lady. Melanie Gibson was, and she reminded me yesterday that she first met me exactly a year ago when I pounced on her
in
this very room and said, you know what, I'm doing a conference and I would very much like to get the new college involved. And Melanie very patiently saw me through this year, organizing it, occasionally sort of getting me back down from the ceiling and saying, it's going to be okay, it's going to be fine. So now we're here, a year later, the conference is happening. I hand over.
Well, I want to welcome you all to New College of the Humanities, which is affectionately known as NCH. It's a college that was founded in 2012. The master is Anthony Groening, who you've heard speak this morning. We offer a new model of education, higher education. It's much closer to a liberal arts college in the US than anything that exists in the UK at the moment. And the students study a major and a minor subject. And on top of that, they also study science literacy, ethics, critical thinking. This all forms part of a much broader curriculum that we hope to offer. That's enough about NCH. I'm now going to hand over to the chair of the session, who is Robert McNamara, who is lecturer, senior lecturer in international history at the University of Ulster. I think that seems like a really good idea. Should we close a bit more even if it's too sunny? Over to you.
This is typical. Now we're complaining about sunshine.
Thank you, Melanie, and thanks to Barbara for asking me to chair the session. I'll just briefly introduce the speakers, a bit of housekeeping. We'll try to keep to around the 20-minute mark per paper, if possible, and that will leave plenty of time for questions. So it gives me a great pleasure to introduce the three speakers. We will begin with Noga Efrati, a senior lecturer at the Open University of Israel. Noga is the author of Women in Iraq, Past Meets Present, published by Columbia University Press in 2012, and she will be talking about the First World War and its legacy for women in Iraq. The second speaker then will be Professor Mark Farha, who is at the Georgetown's University's School of Foreign Service in Doha in Qatar. Mark has written on the Arab revolts, local, regional, and global capitalists and consequences, and he is going to talk about from anti-imperial dissent to national consent, the formation of trans-sectarian national consciousness in the Lebanon. And we will conclude then with a paper from Seda Altug, who has kindly translated the rather difficult Turkish name to a Bosphorus university. She's completed her PhD at Utrecht University and has written recently on remembering the pre-1915 world among the refugees in Syria, religion, land, and history. And her research interests are state society, relations, sectarianism, empire, political economy, colonial and post-colonial Syria. She will be talking about the making of refugee-ness in French Syria between 1921 and 1939. So if I could ask Noga to come forward, please. Thank you.
Thank you very much for inviting me. I'm honored to be here. And I will talk about World War I and its legacy for women in Iraq. And I hope you can hear me. Okay, the notion that the First World War was a watershed in gender relations in European society has characterized contemporary narratives and for a long time also historiography. Women proved their patriotism and fitness for citizenship and were rewarded with political rights. A similar notion can be noted in post-World War I Iraq. If we stretch the period of the war beyond the generally accepted 1914 to 1918 timeline, as some suggest, and include the 1920 revolt, Iraqi women's leaders portrayed the revolt against the British occupation as a defining moment for women. The revolt not only manifested women's nationalist awareness, but also demonstrated their willingness to make sacrifices for their country. It broke down barriers that had prevented them from realizing their capabilities and prompted the call for rights that were their due. Recent scholarship, however, has given more nuanced view of war-related change. New evaluations of the world's war significance for women's citizenship in Europe has not remained as euphoric. Researchers now claim that the war did not necessarily result in full political rights, not to mention citizenship, in many countries, including France, Italy, and even Britain. The legacy of World War I for women in Iraq was in fact worse, and this will be the focus of my talk. British forces occupying Iraq during the war faced the necessity of imposing order over the vast rural countryside, preventing assistance to the Ottoman armies and securing supplies. To this end, and with their understanding of rural areas as tribal, the British sought to enhance the authority of sheikhs. Appointed sheikhs were given responsibility for maintaining order, and in return they were given support, arms, entitled to lands over which they claimed possession. Another means to bolster the position of sheikhs was by prescribing their judicial authority over their tribes. To this end, the British issues in February 1916 a tribal, criminal, and civil dispute regulation. In July 18, the regulation was revisited and reissued. It was perhaps mandated by wartime conditions, but when the war was over, the regulation remained. At the insistence of the mandate authorities, provision for separate tribal jurisdiction was included in Iraq's constitution. In 1924, the tribal regulation became a state law and remained in force until the overthrow of the Hashemite monarchy in 1958. The citizens of Iraq were thus divided into two groups with two different legal systems. The urban population was subject to civil and criminal courts and fell under the jurisdiction of the Baghdad Penal Code. But the rural population was subject to the tribal regulation, which sanctioned and institutionalized customary practices. Much has been written about the tribal regulation, the way it facilitated the cheap, indirect administration of Iraq's vast territories during British occupation, how it reflected the British occupiers' perceptions of the social structure they found therein, and how it provided basis for loyalty to the civil administration and later to the Iraqi government. But its implications for women, which stirred much controversy at the time, have received little scholarly attention. This paper will elaborate on the harsh implications the regulation had for Iraqi women and how it constructed them as non-citizens. My focus here is the British role in this construction, but my argument seeks to add to the re-evaluation of the First World War's significance for women's citizenship globally. British occupation of Iraq brought with it an administration that was largely shaped by the British experience in India. Sir Henry Dobbs, at the time Revenue Commissioner, drew up the tribal regulation along the lines of the colonial code was designed to arrange for the speedy settlement of tribesmen's disputes in accordance with tribal customs by a tribal market, which would include mainly chiefs and sheriffs. But the system as a whole was supervised by and subordinate to the British administration and later to the Iraqi government. The regulation allowed tribesmen to settle their disputes according to tribal custom, but it did not elaborate on the term tribal custom per se. British political officers perceived tribal custom as universal, age-old, and unchanging. Customs concerning women were well known and described as uncompromising and harsh. A woman who lapsed from the strict path of virtue, they reported, brought a stain to the family honor that could be washed away only by her blood. In the settlement of blood disputes, tribes required the guilty party, in addition to paying blood money, to hand over one or more women from his clan to the family of the victim for the purpose of marriage. A woman was compelled to marry her paternal cousin or to receive his consent to marry another man. And if overlooked, the cousin was justified in killing her or her husband. Aberrations were often explained as exceptions to the rule or as deviation from tribal custom. Iraqi opposition to the regulation throughout the Hashemite period encompassed the plight of women as an important thing. Iraqi officials and intellectuals, Sunnis and Shiites, men and women, protested against its harsh implications. Hamad Fadel Jamali, who held high positions in the Ministry of Education, argued in his dissertation on Bedouin education that tribal women were perceived as inferior beings and the possessions of men. He underscored that the use of women in dispute settlements was degrading to those women handed over to an enemy tribe. The renowned poet Maruf Musafi harshly attacked the tribal regulations' recognition of pre-Islamic Jahili customs. Guardians, he protested, perceived their daughters as their property, selling women like sheep and cows. Women were not only excluded from inheritance, but were also inheritable themselves. Women handed over in dispute settlements were disdained, humiliated, and put to work like slaves. Prominent women such as the poet Nazike Malarika and women's leaders Sabiha Sheikh Dawood and Nazeha Dlami protested against the legitimization of honor murders. Dlami argued that women were subservient to men who were in turn subservient to landlords. Like beasts of burden, women might, without recourse, bear the brunt of their husband's anger, be beaten or otherwise maltreated. They understood that opposition might have harsh consequences. They could be easily disposed of through murder. Such an act, Dulani charged, was readily explained away under the pretext of washing away the shame, which was officially recognized as justification for murder. The regulation, as this account revealed, constructed women as tribal possessions and allowed men unbridled power over their lives. British officials were not unaware of these aspects of the tribal regulation. However, British actions were dissonant and often contradictory. Many depicted customs affecting women as barbaric and their implementation through the regulation as foreign to British tradition or a travesty of justice. Some political officers were reluctant to sanction the handing over of women in dispute settlements or imposed punishments on perpetrators of honor murders. One of these political officers, Stuart Edwin Hedgecock, documented the harsh treatment of women under customary law in his 1927 book, Haji Recline. Moreover, British legal experts and advisors in Iraq, such as Edgar Bonham Carter and Edwin Brower, favored the transference of tribal criminal cases to the civil court, which would allow punishment of crimes of honor under the penal code. However, the office of the civil commissioner cautioned against political officers' intervention, noting that such intrusion tends to undermine the force and the appeal of this method of settlement. Oriental Secretary Gertrude Bell advised that such interference was incompatible with the valued law of justice that prompted good conduct and order. In 1923, when the Iraqi Minister of Justice suggested a broad revision of the regulation, including a section stipulating that offenses affecting sexual moral and honor be punishable under the penal code, High Commissioner Dobbs objected, remarking that if there is any case in which tribal feeling is kin and tribal custom necessary to follow, it is the case of adultery and the like. In 1926, Dobbs threatened to invoke his powers under the military agreement should the Iraqi government attempt to emasculate so effective a system of maintaining order in tribal areas. A model suggested by Toby Dodge, which identified two competing British perceptions of how best to govern an alien society, at first glance seem to explain these conflicting positions. Those advocating non-intervention were those Dodge classified as adhering to romantic collectivism. Collectivists saw Iraq as pre-modern and tribal, and thus endeavored to rule the country on the basis of the tribal system, its tribal leaders, and its distinct tribal law. The subscription to the notion of age-old tribal custom was a major justification for deploying the regulation. Interference with practices affecting women challenged this notion and threatened to undermine an effective tool for controlling the countryside. On the other hand, those advocating ideas Dodge classified as rational individualism saw Iraq destined for modernization and viewed the individual as fundamental unit of society. They perceived tribal custom and tribal system as in decay, were sensitive to the lot of individuals, and felt that the regulation should be abolished and tribal law overruled. Yet it would be incorrect to conclude that overall British reticence to intervene in practices pertaining to rural women resulted only from romantic collectivism's dominance. In fact, those touting rational individualism revealed a tendency toward the marginalization of women not unlike that of their colleagues. Saving brown women from brown men, although a goal, was not high on their agenda. Higher priority was given to building a progressive legal system with a civilized government and imposing order. Thus, for example, the main concern of those political officers who punished men who had murdered female relatives was not the lot of women, but rather that a civilized government could not condone such brutal acts of murder. Warren Carter and Rao's support for transferring tribal murder cases to the civil courts reveals a similar set of priorities. Building a progressive legal system required a unified system. The elimination of tribal custom was not an immediate concern. Both men suggested that the civil courts exercise the authority given to them by Article 41 of the Penal Code to punish tribal offenders according to tribal custom. Hedgecock Book was no exception. Despite its grim description, implicit in the author's narration is the resignation to the fact that other considerations took precedence over women's well-being. Although disapproving of the handing over of women in dispute settlements, for example, Hedgecock accepted the utility of the practice. To Western minds, he said, the payment of women payment of a woman in dispute settlement seems intolerable. But the Arabs have learned by long experience that this old method is by far the most effective for ensuring future amity between the tribes and few. This intermarriage brings about a lasting and deep reconciliation. Romantic collectivism and rational individualism, then, were not mutually exclusive British notions as far as practices affecting women were concerned. Though those convinced of the validity of the tribal system tended to legitimize its laws and to moderate criticism that could undermine it. Those who put premium on the building of a modern state allowed the utility of customary law in a society perceived as culturally different. That customs concerning women still saw little British reaction followed from the marginalization of women that was intrinsic to both perceptions. This marginalization was a major factor in defining the nature of women's single status in the emerging state. Administrator and author Stephen Longwick, in his book about Iraq in the first half of the 20th century, described the tribal, criminal, and civil dispute regulation as one of the most valuable legacies of the British regime to Iraq. However, this legacy constructed Iraqi women as tribal possessions, abandoned outside state jurisdiction, rather than citizens whose rights and liberties should be protected. Thank you.
We'll do a second after talk with all three speakers.
After all the three?
Yes.
Thank you. I'll keep this short. This is the scene here in Damascus, May 6th. 1916, and as you, many of you know, I'm sure that the Jamal Pasha, who was referred to today in a little bit, maybe in a more positive fashion, ordered the hanging of mainly journalists, actually, both Christian and Muslim, Druze, Shia, Sunni, Maronite, all religions, and of 40 or so in all. And this is probably the main reason why he's etched in the memory of a lot of Lebanese as being a safah, as a butcher. But so I think, with all the respect to Leila Fawaz, and I agree with her to some degree that he was not, you know, evil incarnate. But, and he has many scenes with the Maronite patriarch, for instance, when he negotiates with him and when he shows himself in a very cordial way. However, by their acts, we shall know them. So his acts vis-a-vis freedom of press, etc., were not exactly laudatory. And this, of course, preceded already before we had us in 1909, for instance, it was a very restrictive Ottoman press law. And what I want to allude to here is the fact that this Ottoman repression, this Turkish Young Turk repression, resulted in a certain, I'm not going to exaggerate here, but in a certain solidarity between Christians and Muslims. Between Muslims who usually were still agitating for unity with Syria, trying to revive the old Arab glory of the empire, and between Christians who were inclined to work with the French and to have an independent Lebanese state. If you actually look at the protagonists on both sides, and I'm not going to go into all the groups because there's a myriad group of papers and activists, but this is basically sort of the division that you have. But if you look at them, you'll find that the Muslims gradually showed themselves open to the Christians and to a unified state. So, for instance, Faisal and his troops had a lot of Christians in demonstration and were intent on reaching out to the Christians. Vice versa, the Christians, despite what we sometimes hear about the Maronites wanting a Maronite state and the French wanting a Maronite state, you don't really find that, actually. And the French are very intent, actually, on creating a laïc state and a state for all, even General Gouron had that idea. And this year is from Khalid Saada, the father of Antoun Saada, who some of you might know, the founder of the Syrian Socialist Party. And he was in exile in Argentina and wrote two very, was the editor of two very interesting papers there. And he said, these are the lines which have motivated me to go into this inquiry, which is, again, that there are no more Muslim, Christian, Druze, and Jew amongst us, for the scaffolds were erected for all alike, and the famine claimed the lives of all equally. And this war has melted us together in this boiling pot, so that we are now Syrians, Lebanese, Palestinians, without distinction of religion or domination. There's a little bit of an exaggeration in this. The famine, for instance, did not really claim the lives of all equally. The Christians, especially the Christians of Mount Lebanon, the Maronites in particular, suffered far more, of course. But it's true that Jamal Pasha, again, you go back to him, also arrested Shia leaders, also arrested Sunni leaders, and there was a kind of a precedent set there for what happens today in Lebanon. If there's an execution in Lebanon, some of you might know this, you cannot really execute just a Sunni or just a Maronite. You always have to be equal in that regard, too. And this was actually started also under Jamal Pasha when he, for instance, the two Chazan brothers, he then had to work Maronite. There were two journalists. He also had to then execute two Sunnis to keep that equality as well. So that's a certain kind of equality, but equality in death, I guess. There is a debate in Lebanese historiography, some of you may be familiar with, launched to some degree by Osama Maqdisi, who stipulated that it's the Europeans who created sectarianism in the Middle East, and without the Europeans, you really wouldn't have had the sectarianism we know today. I disputed that very many, and I'll show you why now as well. And you have here Hamid Farangia, one of the deputies who was responsible for the framing of the Lebanese constitution in 1925-26, who basically gainsayed that claim. And if you, in fact, look at Lebanese history, you find, and this is important later for World War I, we'll see as well, you find that there was an emirate, of course, in the 17th century by Fakhreddin, which is basically the confines of which sort of overlap with the current republic. And why is that important? Because in World War I, when discussion was what kind of state we want after the collapse of the Ottoman Empire, a lot of the groups, as probably Christians, referred back to this emirate and said, this is the natural Lebanon, so to speak. There's the Grand Liban, the Petit Liban, but this was the idea that this was the state, and this is where I conflict with Maqdisi. Maqdisi says before the 18th, 19th century, there was no sectarianism. Well, if you look at the history books here, of course, before that, the Shia and the Mamluks massacring the Shia, you can go back to the beginning of Islam, obviously, the beginning of Christianity, the Catholics, as soon as you have sex, you have sectarianism. It's a trivial observation. But the point is, Fakhreddin was a proto-secular leader. He was someone who was the first Sunni leader to employ, for instance, Shia in his army, and Christians, and etc. So this is important because if you don't recognize this, you won't understand that sectarianism and secularism, or proto-secularism in this sense, exist side by side. And he was indeed then, of course, executed by the Ottomans in 1635 for basically insubordination to the Porte. We have in the 19th century, and some people liken him to Rafiq al-Hariri, because if you recall Rafiq al-Hariri, we don't know exactly who assassinated him, but the claim is that Syria did it. And if that was the case, Fakhreddin was also challenging Damascus, because the Wali, the Ottoman Wali, was in Damascus, always challenging Fakhreddin. So you have this debate, this conflict between Lebanon and Syria, which goes back a long time. In the 19th century, we have Ibrahim Pasha, son of Muhammad Ali, who also tries to establish a non-discriminatory state. And then that, after fails, after the Treaty of London, in fact, 1840, there is another eruption of Druze Maronite clashes in 1860. Which leads to people like Bustani calling for, again, a kind of order which is civil. And this is, again, this dialectic I want to allude to, which is always there, the dialectic of sectarianism and secularism. You have sectarian forces all the time. You also have secular voices coming out. And this is very, very much true for World War I as well, here, where Khalid Saada, whose son then became one of the leading secularists of Lebanese history, emerges, and many people, others like him, who was both against the French and against the Ottomans. He thought that the opposition to the Ottomans was largely infiltrated by French secret services, that the papers were being paid off by them, which is all true, of course, and which came, this is why these people were hung, right? Because they found the documents in the very offices of a certain George Pico in Beirut, which implicated a lot of the opposition figures of having ties and even being financed by the French state. This is one of the papers I've been looking at recently. There's so many papers, unbelievable. It's much greater diversity than today, much greater quality, I would say, as well. This is a Mara founded, again, by a very similar person to comparable to Khalid Sadek, Michel Sapur, and you see already the kind of, you know, entente cordiale, which has emerged. And I don't want to exaggerate it. I'm not saying this was the norm, but I'm saying something emerges there in the face of a common enemy, in this case, Jamal Pasha and the Turkish oppression, which could be called a certain Lebanese unity. And people say Jamal Pasha, and this is Abd al-Hamid II, the Red Sultan, that they're distinct. I think you can find many commonalities in terms of language policy. One of the things which really alienated also the Sunni Muslim Lebanese and Syrians was the fact that the Turks instituted Jamal Pasha, Turkish as the official language. That was also tried by Abd al-Hamid II. So the centralization that was going on in Turkey, I think, is a continuum from 1876 down to the ascent of the Young Turks. So I don't think this division should be made too drastic. I think there's a continuity. Some people could say even to Mustafa Kemal Atatürk, who is just another, you know, and now of course to Erdogan today, which I'll get to later. This is not a very pretty picture, but if you look at Daesh today and all these head shopping contests that are going on in the region, it rings familiar. These are Sharifian troops, I think, in this period. And this is, so you see that the whole affair, because was a bloody one, I don't have too much time, so I can't get into too many of the details. This is the famine that I referred to before. These are original documents of that. And then we have somebody like Khalil Gibran. So where did he fit into all of this? Because again, you have these two poles of Lebanese nationalism and Syrian or Arab unionism. And he combines them all. He says, I'm Lebanese and proud of it. I'm not an Ottoman, I'm proud of that. I stream out Easterner, Syrian my desires, regardless of how much I admire Western progress. And again, I think people like Gibran, like Saada, like Sapur, and many others of them share this kind of sentiment. The Lebanese, you know, nation, nationalism per se was inchoate. It wasn't necessarily as defined as one might think, but it was there and the seeds were being fed along. Okay, and you have others as well who say this as well. One of the political consequences of this period is what I would call is the fundamental trait of Lebanon, or which should be the fundamental trait of all small states, especially diverse small states, which is consociationalism or neutrality and power sharing. And this was actually the general Gouvernance, and said your diversity and your rivalries of race and religion are your weakness. Then one of the Lebanese delegations at the peace conference came up with this notion of neutrality and saying Lebanon does not fight and is not fought. La yuhadith wa la yuhada. And that was later, again, reiterated in the National Pact, which was the foundation of modern Lebanon, in 1943, where it says Lebanon is not going to be a transit point for wars, nor a transition point, I don't know how to say it. So wars won't come from Lebanon, wars should not come through Lebanon. Of course, what's happened today with Syria, if you think about it, how many thousands, hundreds of troops came through Lebanon to Syria, through Turkey to Syria. So now, and before that, how many times have the Syrians, of course, invaded Lebanon and attacked Lebanon? That was violated many times. But the idea was, in principle, and still today being adhered officially by the Lebanese government, is to remain neutral amidst all this diversity, because that is always very difficult to realize. But I just want to refer to the fact that this, what we consider to be a sort of a fundamental trait of the current Lebanese political system, has a precedent in 1920 as well. And here you see the transformation. This is the commission which was ordered to form the Lebanese constitution in 1925, led by Michel Shiha, who really founded it. And you see here the flag in 1920 that they had, which illustrates this sort of hybridity of the Lebanese constitution. Lebanese constitution is a mix between first 10 sort of articles, if you want, of the French constitution, or inspired by it, sometimes directly, and confessional concessions. And now, contrary to what we always hear, that it's the evil foreigner who introduced those confessional concessions in the Lebanese constitution, in fact, it was this commission, and I've looked at the whole documents and discussions in it, And they, some members, the majority of members, with one exception, insisted on confessionalism as being part and parcel of the system. You can understand if you're a Maronite to some degree, you don't want to, after this famine, after this devastation wrought by World War I, where you lost one third of your population in Mount Lebanon, you obviously don't want to be subjected to that again, and don't want to, for that reason, you know, join a greater Arab pan-Syrian state. Even though, again, Faisal and others were constantly saying, no, no, don't be afraid, you know, we will be open to the Christians and minorities. But still, so the confessional concessions are born of fear, if you want, and distrust, and they still remain to the very day. But to blame it on the French, I think, is a simplification of history. And here we have a rare picture of all the sects assembled. By the way, in 1920, I was just reading yesterday in the papers that the Maronite patriarch refused to have a gathering of all the other sectarian heads because he saw himself as being superior. Jamal Pasha actually invited him and all the heads to a dinner, and the Maronite patriarch then, Fouayek, refused. This is fair, and in this situation, it's a very rare picture, but it's not easy to find the whole thing. Oh, I'm repeating myself here. I have not much time. This is something, again, which illustrates what I'm talking about, this dialectic. Which are the two countries in the Middle East which are most inclined towards secularism or secular states? It's Lebanon and Iran. Why is that, in my view? Because these two states have faced the most severe sectarian war of all the other states. So once you're a burnt child, you tend to be more amenable to a solution beyond the sort of false promises of holy war and jihad. That, by the way, is Antun Saad, the son of, and I don't have time to go into this, the son of Khalid Saad. Okay, let's go to today, because I think this is an important thing. You remember the French plan was original, but they had that for a while. They created Greater Lebanon. They also created the four other states, which then were integrated into a single Syrian state. And today, let me just go there because we don't have too much time. Today we have the division fundamentally, for instance, if you ask who killed Hariri, fundamentally the division between Shia and Sunni. It's no longer Christian Muslim, it's Shia and Sunni. And the question is, and here you have still Sunni groups in Lebanon, Hizb al-Tahrir, for instance, which is in 2006, way before Daesh and ISIS, gainsaying or doubting the legitimacy of the Lebanese state, saying basically that we need a Muslim caliphate. So what we're seeing today in Syria in terms of this radicalism has roots which go back, you can say, all the way, you know, way back, but it also goes back before the actual, even the war in Iraq. I think the war in Iraq was, of course, something that really affected. And here's something a little bit controversial, but I would like to refer to it because I think it's important. The U.S. has been basically taking sides in the Sunni-Shia conflict for now, more or less. Well, it's sort of flirting with both sides, and Obama says that as well. But in the Arab uprising, it took sides with the Islamists. This is in Libya and elsewhere. And John Kerry, at that point, a member in Congress, was saying that the Syrian opposition is all-inclusive, minority-protecting, and that there are only 10% or so of people who would not adhere to a secular state. Obama said openly, I think there's a distinction between the capacity for reach of bin Laden and a network that is attacking the US and jihadists who engage in various local power struggles. So the calculation is, okay, we have these beasts down there, they're fighting the Iranian beasts, let them fight each other, and we have divide and rule. And that is something, of course, which goes back to a long time, to, if you want, to the British and French involvement in the region as well, although I think that's... Today, I think it's even more dangerous. So if we're comparing 2014 to 1914, what's the difference? The difference to me is, in 1914, the direct involvement was there, but it was temporary. And today, you have, maybe not, you know, US troops and French troops and British troops, but you have an active sponsorship of thousands of jihadists being coordinated through Turkey and elsewhere to foment this violence. So I think it's even more dangerous than in 1914 to some degree. Also Russia, et cetera, and Iran are there. And they're not going to give this up. This is a war of sort of survival, and there's no other way about it. Oftentimes when you talk about this, again, you have this notion either sectarianism is a Western invention, or the other notion that basically saying it's their own fault. I think both are wrong. Okay, so Hassan Makis and others have, you know, in the apologetic discourse in the region, the historians, etc., saying that it's the evil West that's concocted these things. It's nonsense. I think that doesn't go very far. I also think it's obviously nonsensical to say that there was no foreign involvement, especially since we have official statements and acts left, right, and center. And it's often used to cut off the debate on this kind of intervention, and it leads to the statements, for instance, that to say that, you know, they are their own fault. Something that about the press, when you evaluate press in 1914 and 2014, it's always difficulty there as well. When I look at the papers, for instance, from the Ittihad al-Othmani or the Dissent al-Hal or al-Mara, all these papers, some of them were working with the Ottoman authorities, some with the French authorities, some were independent, but often they will not state the full truth because they're under a lot of pressure to repress matters. So if you're talking about Jamal Pasha, you want to find sources on Jamal Pasha, it's going to be very difficult because the official press was censored and they would often say it in a more, even the patriarch himself would say things by ways of dissimulation to sort of avoid a harsher punishment. You know, you're living in a reign of terror, so to speak. It was like under Saddam or Assad or whatever. It's very difficult to use this press. Now, the Western press has also left a lot to be asked for. It's, for instance, we have BBC itself. When Hassan Nasrallah, there was a bombing in 2012 in the Beirut suburb, 50 or so Shia died, and Hassan Nasrallah went on TV and said, anyone who accuses the dear Sunni Taifa sect is an Israeli agent. Because he didn't want to, obviously, from his Shia minority perspective, foment the Sunni sectarian fire. What does the New York Times and the BBC do? BBC says Hezbollah blames Sunnis for bombing, which is exactly the inverse of what he said. And here you see it. This sectarian is not Sunnis, blah, blah, blah. And the New York Times did the same thing. They later changed it a little bit, the title, but they still kind of put it in sectarian language, which is not, I mean, he might be sectarian in his inner heart and in his acts, etc., but in fact, he's trying to sort of avoid. Same thing with Bashar al-Assad, of course, who has a Sunni wife who goes to Sunni mosques, who builds Sunni mosques all the time. So the sectarianism here is used, I think, by the press in an irresponsible way. And it is also used by the states in an irresponsible way. This is Mahari, one of the famous Arab poets who was hacked as by ISIS, or Jabhat al-Nusra, I think it was. And the Israeli ambassador openly said that when he asked, you know, we always wanted sort of, preferred the bad guys who weren't backed by Iran to the bad guys who were backed by Iran. And that was the case even if the other bad guys were affiliated to Jabhat al-Nusra al-Qaeda. That is a position we had well before the outbreak of the hostilities. With the outbreak of hostilities, we continue to want Assad to go. And indeed, they bombed, you know, Syria about 8 times, and they've never bombed Jabhat al-Nusra so far. But they might change eventually. For Lebanon, 3 options remain, the same 3 options that remained in 2014. Then it was the idea, do you want a small Lebanon up here, or do you want the big Lebanon that we have here? They decided the big Lebanon for many reasons. One was historical, because of Fakhreddin, the original emirate, but the more important reason was because of the grain. They wanted to have the fertile valleys here, which are, of course, if you have the mountain here, and this is all open, in a sense, part of Syria, if you want, but the valleys here were necessary to prevent a further famine, which we had in the First World War. So this is the idea. If you want to divide this now in sectarian terms, it's going to be messy, it's not going to work, in my view, and it's also what we have for the whole region as a whole, if you want to, you know, divide this even more in different regions. The other idea is what actually happened in Lebanon, which is a division of spoils, which happened every time after every conflict they had. In 1845 is one of them, Shakib Effendi, later again in Mutasarifia from 1861 and on to the First World War, and of course with the current system as well. So this is power sharing, dividing the power amongst the groups, la velik wa la maghlub, no victor, no vanquished. And that's the lessons, the bitter lessons of the Lebanese Civil War, of all wars that happened in Lebanon. And the third one is the ultimate goal, which is integration. And this is the statue of the martyrs commemorating, a wonderful statue, I must say, World War I, commemorating the family, commemorating, I think there's an urn here of a child, I think is the idea, and it's a Muslim woman and a Christian woman by a Lebanese sculptor, which was actually defaced then in the 60s by a fundamentalist, so to speak. And then Kamil Shamoun took it down and put up the current statue you have in the center of Beirut in Martyrs Square, which is a very martial one with by in metal by an Italian artist. So I think this is much better. I think it's a big mistake to have done. Why do you have a foreigner? Why do you have one in metal, which is very martial and about war, rather than one which is more reflective and pensive? And that's what the country needs. It needs reflection. It needs a self-accounting, self-introspection, rather than a kind of a celebration of yet more war. And sometimes this quote, I don't know those of you who are Germans or something, is attributed to others, but I just like to say an Arab, Ali Mas'udi, who wrote a wonderful history, of course, with Muruj al-Dahab, said this, and I hope it's not true. This is from a recent situation in Egypt, I think, where a little Muslim girl drew a mosque consoling a church. This was after the Ikhwan upright, or a counter coup, if you want, against the Ikhwan when the churches were burnt. So she did that, and I think that is a hopeful sign. This is after the Hariri assassination, when you had the biggest demonstration in Lebanese history from all sects, with the exception to some degree of the Shia. So only very few Shia, mainly Sunni and Christian. That too fell apart, of course, in wake of what we have now of this sectarian upsurge again. So it's I think it's not impossible, but it's it will require for the Lebanese an introspection, for the outside powers an abstaining of arming these conflicts in a cynical way, because I think it's going to explode. It's worse than 1914. Because the regional stakes are higher, the integration of Iran, Turkey, and all these other states, developed states, Saudi and Qatar, where I'm coming from, into these conflicts are such that that it will spill over. And I think, for instance, Qatar, which I can speak for as studying there, did a wonderful job in 2008 from preventing a civil war by, as a Sunni state, almost allying with the Shia to some degree. I mean, at least favoring their fomenting or being the architect of a power sharing plan 2008, which is the only way for Lebanon to go, unless you want to break it up. But for Lebanon to break up into sectarian cantons will not work, because Hezbollah will not give up its connection to Syria, which we're seeing now, which is connected to Iran, so then you have the whole region. So you see that Lebanon itself cannot be disassociated. It's like a thread. If you take it out, the whole thing will unravel. So that's my humble opinion here, and I look forward to some discussion. Thank you.
Therefore, it is also going to be related to the refugee issue and the memory issue that Leyla Fawaz was talking today in the morning in the opening speech. So, the great majority of today's Syrian Armenians, not today, of course, the Syrian Armenians who used to reside there, who used to live there before the Syrian uprising started in March 2011, so my talk is mainly based on my research, which I made before the Syrian uprising started in 2011. So a great majority of them are the descendants of Ottoman Armenians who survived the 1915 Armenian genocide in the Ottoman Empire. And 1,200,000, between 1,200,000 and 1,500,000 deportees in Ottoman Syria who had hoped to return to their homeland as soon as World War I was over in 1980, returned to Cilicia, the region of Adana and Mersin, the Eastern Mediterranean, I would say. They were hoping to return to their homeland as soon as the war was over, but obviously they could not, because all of their hopes of returning vanished following the Turkish National Liberation War, which lasted between 1919 and 1921, and which eventually led to the ceding of Cilicia, that region where the those Armenians that I'm talking about originate from, had to stay in Syria with the ceding of that region to the Turkish Republic after the formalization of the Turkish-Syrian border, in which was signed in October 1921. So during these years, which between 1918 and 1921, the killing, intimidation, abduction, and stigmatization of the Armenians in Cilician cities continued and culminated in a second Armenian exodus towards French Syria and Lebanon. And between 1921 and 1923, 80,000 new Armenian refugees arrived in Syria and Lebanon by land or by sea. Yet there is a third way of expulsion of Armenians towards French Syria, in particular the northeastern part of Syria, which in the map that you just presented, you stated that the whole region, excluding the Sanjak of Alexandria, the Alevite region and the Druze region, it is called, you stated that it is the state of Aleppo, but actually the northeastern part of Syria is also an autonomously administered region, which is mostly inhabited by Kurds, Armenians, and other Christians, again originating from Turkey, from the Kurdish part of Turkey. And this is the third wave of expulsion towards that region, towards French Syria. And it took place after 1925, after Turkey's military suppression of the Kurdish Sheikh Said revolt in the Diyarbakir. So this third Armenian exodus to that northeastern part of Syria, it according to the figures compiled by the League of Nations, 8,000 between 8,000 and 10,000 Kurdo-Armenians, as named by the French sources, Kurdish Armenians, because they are Kurdophones, found refugee in Syria, and they joined the earlier Armenian deportees. Yet the history of the post-genocide world in Syria is not assessed critically. There are very few scholarly works who have incorporated the social and political history of the refugees into the general history of Syria. So obviously one of the underlying reasons is the politics of fear, obviously, which is embodied in space, in people's minds and bodies, and it is quite effective among scholars as well. Obviously this scholarly field, because of this politics of fear, it inevitably silences and marginalizes the controversial historical phenomenon from scholarly scrutiny, such as the issue of sectarianism or the refugee issue. The same politics of fear accompanied by the Syrian Basi sectarianism underlie the Syrian Armenian common sense too. In the Christians, not only Armenians, but Christians, refugees' memories, history is presented as already clean, in a self-made way, without any process of negotiation or resistance. And it leaves no room for tracking the confrontations and transformations in the political and social subjectivities. And in this presentation, I'm going to delve into the Syrian-Armenian common sense through shedding some light on the refugee experiences upon their arrival. So more significantly, in the Syrian-Armenian memory, 1915, which is directly identified with the war itself, the genocide, it is seen as decisive event, a violent ending, but also as a new beginning and a new period of struggle in a hostile and foreign setting in Syria. The 1915 violence, which took definitely different forms in social, class, cultural, and geographical terms, it constitutes the foundation of all historical narratives, be local history or extensive narratives of violence of all, local history or the history of the French Mandate. The refugees' narratives begin with the lengthy and extensive narratives of violence of all kinds that were exposed back in the hometowns or on the way to or prior to their arrival in Syria. An entire life was left behind in an absolute fashion and would never be returned. It is remembered with extreme grief, with its fields, trees, rivers, climate, and the new refuge, which is Syria, is never really a substitute. And again, in the narratives of the refugees, the French mandate rule, which is found upon arrival to Syria, and the colonial agency are obscured or rather assimilated into a survival narrative where the main provider is depicted as the Syrians, if not the Armenian community itself. The new life in French Syria indicates a positive change from bad to good, namely from insecurity, fear, instability, and oppression to security, stability, and tolerance in Syria, in French Syria. Generosity and respect on the part of Syrian Arabs are presented as the underlying factors in the safety and security. No mention at all is made of the distress or discomfort felt by the local Syrians due to the refugee flow to French Syria, nor of the dominant French colonial perspective on the Christian refugees and the fragile bargaining between the two, between the French colonials, French colonial power and the refugees, representatives of the refugees, of course. Nor there is no mention of the tacit agreement that is made between the Arab nationalists and later the Armenian establishment, the Armenian leadership of the late, of the early, I'm sorry, 1930s. So obscuring the colonial period as well as the current state of things in Syria, while underscoring the 1915 memories, is not a mere coincidence, obviously. Lack of the post-genocide Armenian experience in Syria is apparently related to the repressive conditions that, that have existed in Syria since the independence 1946, but also more importantly, being the unacknowledged victims of the Turkish nationalist venture and given the lack of space for the Syrian Armenian narrative to be recognized in Turkey, the Syrian Armenian memory can be considered as an unrecognized reminder of a historical and still ongoing repression. And now I'm going to briefly talk about the refugee issue, as brief as possible. I may take more time, apologies for that, in advance. So there is almost no integrated history of the controversial encounter between the newcomer refugees and the local Arab population, local Syrian population, Muslim and Christian, during the early days of the French colonial rule in Syria. Despite being under-researched, the refugee issue was one of the most controversial issues in post-World War I Levant, posing serious concerns not only for the governing colonial powers and the home state, but also for the displaced and the host populations. And concerning the French authorities, colonial authorities, so they were concerned with the economic, social, and political costs of settling refugees in inner Syria or along the Turkish-Syrian frontier zone. They had to deal with the refugee issue without running into a deep crisis of legitimacy, both in the eyes of the Muslim majority in Syria and the locals, local as well as the refugee Christians in Syria. Justifying their presence in Syria and Lebanon as the protectors of Oriental Christians, the mandate authorities had to avoid increasing anxiety among Syrian Arab nationalists. French diplomatic archives are full of reports drafted in 1920s about the refugee populations, in particular the Armenians and Kurds from Turkey and Assyrians from British Iraq, and various settlement projects concerning these two groups, these three groups actually. These documents demonstrate that the French mandatory state did not adopt a comprehensive refugee policy, but embraced a pragmatic approach that took into account particular political, economic, diplomatic, and social concerns. And in the meantime, of course, the Turkish state was fearful, that there is a Turkish state, and which is fearful of an, I quote, enclave of undesirables, end quote, in particular the Armenians and Kurdish political refugees, forming outside of its control, just south of its own border. And there are numerous correspondences, again, between Ankara and the French High Commissariat in Beirut and its delegate in Damascus. And these correspondences display that, display the Turkish complaints over malicious elements in the form of Armenians in the frontier zone and rebellious Kurdish tribes residing in the northeastern part of Syria. The settlement of Armenians along the Turkish-Syrian border, their recruitment into the French administration and into French army, and transborder incursions by Kurds into Turkey from Syria, these three topics form the sine qua non topic of the intelligence reports, telegrams, and correspondences between 1925 and 1927. The French, by the Turkish state, is criticized for providing protection to Kurdish rebels and allowing the settlement of Armenians in areas near the border. And the French central authorities, especially those in Beirut and those in Paris, were very well aware of the need to regulate the refugee flow. The High Commissariat in Beirut had, after 1925, became more responsive to the demands by the Turkish Foreign Ministry. In a report drafted after the Kurdish Şeyh Said revolt in 1925 and entitled, and apologies for my bad pronunciation of French, Du passage en Syrie des populations kurdes chrétiennes ou des déserteurs turcs, the High Commissar Maurice Sarre openly proposed to Paris to, I quote, organize the regulations pertaining to accepting refugees in Syria, end quote. Despite the pragmatic approach adopted by the French central authorities, certain local officers, especially in the autonomous administered regions, still held their ground and took initiative in the settlement of the refugees, in particular Kurdish refugees from Turkey. For instance, let me give you a quote of a local French officer. He describes the Turkish allegations of Armenian colonization on the border as mistaken and exaggerated. I quote, since the beginning of the armistice, the biggest problem that the mandatory power is trying to resolve is the refugee problem. We have received 96,450 refugees since then, and they are all impoverished people. France has made great economic sacrifices for them. Just for the sake of relieving pressure on the north of Syria, we have settled two-thirds of these poor people in inner Syria. The rest resides in Aleppo and the Sanjak of Alexandretta, and their settlements were realized calmly and in deference to the Muslim population, end quote. And now the Syrian Arab nationalists, how they view the refugee problem. It was a hotly debated issue, and until mid-1920s, it was as much a political issue as it was a social and economic problem, especially the settlement of refugee groups, in particular Armenians, in inner Syrian cities. Relief, food programs, and settlement arrangements were offered to, in particular to Armenian refugees by several missionary organizations, as well as the French mandatory authorities. And the refugee issue, along with the French surrender of some Syrian land to Turkey, formed the two major criticisms that the Arab nationalist elites expressed their indignation towards the French. So, the arrival and settlement of the refugees in Syria was directly linked to colonial divide and rule politics. The flow of refugees into the Syrian space, which persisted through the 1920s, evoked a lack of agency because of a sovereignty deficit in the Syrian national self. Arguing that Syria had turned into a whore, and this is a term that is very much used in the newspapers from the mandate period, the Arabic newspapers, that Syria had turned into a whore as refugees could freely penetrate the country. There several articles in the national press demanded regulation of the border without regard to ethnicity and the religion of the refugee group. And of course, the French strategy of reinforcing and expanding the political spaces reserved for the Armenians in the new confessional system in French Syria, it worsened the situation. And the biggest discomfort was experienced in Aleppo, and it was translated into clashes between different between communities, the newcomers and local community. And it became very much apparent during the elections in 1926 and 1928, And during the Great Revolt in 1925, the Great Anti-Colonial Revolt in 1925, because the French used Armenian soldiers against the anti-French rebels in Syria. So the third wave of expulsion of Armenians that I talked in the beginning of my presentation, it actually caused extreme alarm and anxiety among the Arab nationalists. And their uneasiness about this third wave, it caused, it was expressed in a new framework though, and namely the harmful strangers versus the outraged Syrians. And because of this increasing anxiety among the locals, a joint declaration by the main Armenian political parties, Trinçak and Daşnak, was published in an Arabic written article in the journal Le Liban in May 1930, in order to reassure the Arab nationalists that there would be no founding of an Armenian state in Syria. I quote, we only have one homeland, that is Armenia. In this hospitable country, our unique effort is to provide the needs of our families and assure the education of our children. We would like to see that the cordial relations between the Arabs and the Armenians are maintained, and the misunderstandings that give rise to suspicions are overridden. And lastly, the last part, the last thing that I'm going to talk about is the changing discourse about the refugees starting from 1936. And this very much is, we can see the remnants of this, debate that was made in 1936 still today, still after the Syrian uprising started. And 1936 is the date where an agreement between the Arab nationalists and the French was made, and according to this agreement, this agreement promised independence to Syria within the next 5 years, and it foresaw the incorporation of these autonomously administered regions into a Damascus-centered unified Syria. So, yet the treaty was never ratified. So Syria did not become independent in 1941 as the treaty foresaw. Yet the fierce controversy over the two fundamental articles of the treaty, namely the protection of minorities and the unity of Syria under with the capital being Damascus, has had long-lasting implications concerning Syrian Christians in general and Armenians in particular. So these controversies involve two opposing political movements in French Syria. The unionists, those who opted for a unified Syria, and the autonomists, those who opted for the preservation of those autonomously administered regions. And since I don't have much time, I'm going to cut it short. But within those 3 years between 1936 and 1939, thanks to the debates that were made around the minorityness and about the territory issue in Syria, the interrelation between the political dissidents and minority and refugee status in the Syrian Arab nationalist imagery has become really apparent thanks to the autonomy movement in the northeastern part of Syria. Because the autonomist faction in this part, northeastern part, those who wanted to keep their autonomous status, they asked for a special minority status and for the continuation of the autonomous rule. Yet the unionists in other parts of Syria, but also the unionists in the northeastern part of Syria, they argued that, especially Prime Minister Sadullah Jabri at the time, he argued that, I quote, ex-refugees of the 1920s have integrated and become like us. Thus, they should not be asking for special treatment, end quote. The Arab nationalists labeled the autonomy movement in the northeastern part as refugees who deny favor in a very upbraiding rhetoric. The leaders were accused of lacking goodwill. And eventually, thanks to these discussions and public debates, and of course violence accompanying that public debate, the notion of refugee came to stand only for the minority and represent the interest-seeker dissident rebel. And as minorities conjured up the image of political dissidents contesting the ideological hegemony of the nationalist discourse of organic national harmony, the majority among the ex-refugees soon conjured up the image of simple people who are only interested in their daily bread, but nothing else. In a way, the ex-refugees, in particular the Armenians, entered the post-colonial era after they were castrated of their transformative political agency. And until 1940s, French-Syria was still a refuge for thousands of undesirables of Turkish nationalism for whom they had no place in Turkey. The bargain between the colonial power and the Armenian refugees contributed relatively to the social and economic betterment of the Armenians at the expense of the formation of a distinct and sectarian Armenian identity. While the bargain between the Armenians, the refugees, and the local Arab nationalists helped to calm the ever-lost feeling of security and stability among the refugees, but only through a patrimonial relationship and at the expense of free political agency submitted to the power holder. Nevertheless, the memories of horrors of 1915 were evoked during several instances, during the Muslim Brotherhood uprising in Hama in 1981, the Kurdish resistance in Kamishlo in 2003, and obviously during the current days of turmoil in Syria. Memories of 1915 and the oppressive regime generate a politically conformist discourse. Oppressive regime in Syria, the Baasi Syria, generate a politically conformist discourse among the Syrian Armenian establishment and the community at large. The spell of the past will start to crumble, however, when the 1915 violence is acknowledged. And as Walter Benjamin said, when the, I quote, causes of what happened then have been eliminated. Thank you, and sorry for taking time.
Can I invite the speakers to sit up here? Take away James' microphone. That's James. Could I ask, we have about roughly half an hour for questions, is that okay? I think the best way to proceed maybe is that I'll take three questions, one for each speaker first, just as group, and then we'll just open it to the floor with this gentleman.
Sorry,
could I just ask, could each person who asks a question, could they say who they are and where they're from?
My name is Alfred Farha, I'm from Syria. And my question is for Ms. Efrati. Women in Iraq. As I'm sure you're well aware, it was in the 20s when the Great Britain in England, in particular Churchill, I believe the Foreign Secretary, brought in the Hashemite King Faisal in payment, the repayment, if you will, for his support against the Ottomans. And at that time in Iraq, the king to be was Talat al Latif in Basra. I know the family well, so he was in the And then afterwards, it was very interesting what happened in Iraq, because you had a very strong, a lot of Jews in Baghdad, who were very highly respected, Christians in Baghdad, or Sunnis, to a lesser extent Shia. But to my knowledge, this is what I wanted to ask you, it would seem to me that it was through perhaps some of the rulings of the Hashemite king, Faisal and his successors, down to his grandson, who was assassinated in the revolution in 58, that was perhaps the reason for the suppression of women, or was it just tribal?
Okay, come on, we just, can you take that? Yes.
But she answered the question first.
Can we just take them as a group first and then...
Whatever you want to get. If you don't mind,
sorry. Thanks.
Thanks, Max Weiss. I am going to violate your request just by asking a splinter question to Seda and to Mark, if that's okay.
That's fine, yes.
So the question to Seda, thank you, it was a really stimulating paper. You said a couple of things, I just want to throw out the phrases you used and I invite you to give us a little bit more in terms of what you meant by them. The first is sovereignty deficit. Often international historians of the mandates talk about a surplus of sovereignty and the lack of, pardon the term, there are many who don't believe in it, legitimacy. So do you want to explain a little bit more what you mean by sovereignty deficit? And the other term you used, which I thought, or the phrase that you shared that I thought was very interesting, was the refugee could only appear as a minority. And so you're talking about both the status, the term, and also the condition. And I wondered, to whom can the refugee only appear as a minority? Are you talking about to French mandate administrators, or are you talking about to international agencies? I would think there are different conceptions of how those terms are meaningful. Mm-hmm. So I wondered if you could talk about that.
Okay, could I just get one from Mark, and then we can...
Yeah, I was going to ask a question to Mark also, if that's okay.
Yes,
I
guess
I can wait to the general session if you prefer. The question is how I think the burden of proof on those who would like to argue that sectarianism and secularism are timeless historical concepts, the burden of proof rests with those who make that argument. So I was hoping you could say a little bit more about that, because I think one of the comments you made was that there has been sectarianism as long as there have been sects, and I think that's a very controversial way to think about sectarianism. I think sectarianism, I've written about this, Osama has written about this, as you say, but the more dangerous concept is not to suggest that the Europeans are guilty of fomenting sectarianism. The more dangerous concept is to accept it as a timeless historical phenomenon, to my mind. So I was hoping you could say a little bit more about your ideas about proto-secularism or proto-sectarianism or timeless sectarianism, as I heard you describing it. I can cut it. Cut my comment question there.
Okay, thank you. No, do you want to? Do you just want to start?
Okay.
Well,
I first of all, it's a good question, and I will say that this. Faisal was supportive of women's education. However, by the end of the mandate period, you had maybe 15,000 educated women and maybe 5% literate in 1958. So he was supporting education, but not much was done. And you have, I think we should look at it as a system. And we should go back to David Poole and the way he showed how the sheikhs and the sharif, the sharifians, or the people who came with Faisal to Iraq, got together and became the new elite of Iraq. And within this new system, you had tribal chefs ruling their tribes or judging their tribes, and women were oppressed through this legal system, which institutionalized.
But was that oppression mainly amongst the Muslim population? Because I know Jews who lived in Baghdad, I know Christians as well who lived during that time, and I think they did rather well. I don't know that there was supposed to be about oppression, at least not of women.
Okay, so you're right. I was talking basically about rural women in Baghdad, which was the majority of the population. In Baghdad, of course, you have to look at the urban setting and the rural setting, different classes, etc. but rural women were the majority of women. And also, through the penal code, you can tribalize urban women. And we have a very famous case in 1932, the daughter of Sadun, Prime Minister Sadun, who committed suicide a year earlier, getting married to someone outside her tribe, and her tribe is killing her husband, which is, you know, and she was basically an urban woman. She was actually, her mother was Turkish. She was completely urban, okay, so,
yeah. I see that.
First, I'm going to start with the easy question, the second one, because it was already in my presentation, yet I didn't, out of time. So this, the equalization, the identification of the concept of minority, the category of minority and the refugee by whom, actually the notion of minority, it was contested by the autonomists, those who are supporting the continuation of the French mandate and the preservation of the autonomous status. Yeah, the notion was contested between them and those who are supporting union with Syria. And the autonomists promoted a relatively more ethno-religious definition of minority. And they asked special protection of those minorities defined in that way against the majority, which they defined as the Sunni Arabs. And they wanted to be included in the new constitution. And the Sunni are the unionists in general. It might be Christians. I mean, intersectarian group of unionists. They opted for the strategy of incorporating the ethno-religious belonging into Syrian Arab national identity. And in that sense, they asked for from the autonomous, I would say, to obscure and depoliticize their ethno-religious difference. Like this, which you know, this national slogan, which says religion is for God and the nation is for all. So obviously, those who did not depoliticize and those who did not obscure their ethno-religious belonging came to be identified with being a minority. And those who argue that they are minorities because they are latecomers to the country, because they came to the country, you know, in 1930s, and they have not been autochthones of that region like the rest of the Syrians are, and on that basis asked for special protection from the French, were considered as, I mean, were considered as minorities, arguing against the unification of the country. In that sense, looking from the perspective of the Syrian Arab nationalists who strive for the unity of the country, equated minorityness and refugeeness. So it is my fault I did not mention that. And as for the sovereignty deficit, which was very much, you know, expressed in the Arab press in 1920s, actually after the third wave of expulsion. That started in 1925 in particular, the Syrian Arab nationalists, the Aleppino, those from Aleppo and those from Damascus, very regularly argued that their sovereignty is stolen from them by the French, obviously, and there is this deficit, there is this lag, and there is this deferral. The independence is so, the days of independence are so vague and are so, you know, is going to happen at an unknown date. The independence is very much deferred. Thus, there is this lag, thus, there is this deficit. They use the word deficit in Arabic, that they lack in sovereignty, in self-rule, in, self-sovereignty of their country.
I'll just be short. Hi, Max. Nice to meet you in person. I don't know if you misunderstood me. I mean, I'm not a primordialist, pure and simple. I mean, so there's two guys. They say one, it's what you're alluding to, is primordial instinct to the business. The other is it's an invention, you know, created later. I just, I don't think, however, you can look at any of this. I mean, look at the Islamist groups today. They refer back to Ibn Taymiyyah, who's back in the 13th century, right? Castigating the Christians and the Shia and saying the Alawites are worse than the atheists. I have students in Qatar who are Sunni Muslim who refer back to him. So even if you or I might not, you know, take that, they take it seriously. And it is, I mean, I think it's, I don't know what the debate is. The debate, to me, it's clear that yes, as soon as you have, you know, when Islam enters the scene, very soon after you have Ulul Fitna, these things come up, and people today refer back to those categories, right? So you have to take them seriously, otherwise you can't make rhyme or reason for what's going on today.
No,
you want to respond?
Yeah, no, I mean, I think it's a fair point, but if we don't try to consider the meaning of the concepts and the categories and even the terms in the historical context they are used, we're losing something very significant. So simply because Ibn Taymiyyah is referred to doesn't mean, first of all, that his opinions are even accurate, given the fact that he's actually referring to Ismailis when he is talking about the need to kill Alawis. He doesn't use the term. He uses the term Ali to describe Fatimids, so he's actually like got an impoverished historical conception himself, or an impoverished understanding.
Right, but it's very potent.
But all I mean to say is the invocation of Ibn Taymiyyah in the 20th and 21st century is quite different than whatever Ibn Taymiyyah meant to say in the 13th century.
Well, not that different. I agree, but not that different. Many are the reasons, but death is one. I mean, at the end of the day, he is not somebody, and this is how I defend secularism, to answer that question maybe. It's non-discrimination, right? So now the secularism of a, say, of a Fakhreddin or Ibrahim Pasha is maybe not the same secularism of, I don't know, French laicism, etc. But still, there are seeds there of non-discrimination, and I don't think you can appreciate those if you don't see the other side, like, you know, of violent, and you know, chauvinists. And they were there from the start. And yes, they change in every Makan was a man, in every context, sits and live in history. Of course, it's a different dynamic. Of course, it's a different. And I agree with Maktasi and everyone else on that. But I don't agree with the fact, and I think it's very dangerous to, and it's apologetic. And the Islamists certainly use that too by saying that sectarianism is a creation of a colonial West or something of that sort.
Yeah, but Mark, come back to that. It's quite remarkable that the groups that are picked by the British in Iraq and the French in Syria tend to come from the minorities, and they tend to maintain their power. So the Hashemites are obviously Sunnis in a predominantly Shia country, and then they're replaced by Baathists that are predominantly Shia, or sorry, Sunni in Iraq with Saddam Hussein and his and the groupings around him, and then the Alawites are. If I remember the backbone of the troop specials in Syria, and that helps them dominate the post-war Syrian army after independence in 45, which allows people like Assad to kind of their means of ascent to the top. And it's that kind of extraordinary mistakes made at that time by the French and the British that create the tensions that the majorities in both Syria and Iraq are basically disenfranchised for. Virtually the entire 20th century.
Yeah. Yes and no, but it's something they play with. Right? You go to Switzerland and you try to rile up the Protestants and the Catholics, and they won't work anymore because there's no fertile ground for that. So the Americans going to Iraq, yes, I agree, everything, but the sectarianism is very. People say, oh, there was no sectarianism back in the 50s, whatever, but it's not true. I mean, if you look at the actual writings, if you actually, you know, marriage patterns, etc., and other things, and massacres, even if you go back, that was there. So I think there's an interaction between the two. That's all I'm saying. The dialectic. I agree, but it's not a one-sided thing.
Sorry.
So I have a question for Dr. Efrati. You were talking a lot about.
Just say who you are.
I'm from Harrison Guthrie, a doctoral candidate at the University of Maryland. You were talking a lot about the use of kind of the distinction of tribal law opposed to urban law, whether or not they should have been two categories, and then it's all been kind of. This feeling from the British and the Iraqi government of trying towards a progressive judicial system that does and doesn't work. Is that more a case of a continuation of kind of Ottoman policy, where the Ottomans, and I know at least in Transjordan, there was a tribal judicial sphere, and then there was kind of Kanun that applied to settled populations, and the British, at least in Transjordan, more or less continually perpetuate that until they're forced to change it later in the 30s. So I was curious if you saw a similar kind of progression, or is this a distinctly separate case?
Yeah, just
okay.
Well, first of all, thank you. It's a good question, and I'm looking into it more carefully now, going back in time. But as far as I know, and as far as others have written about it, the main difference here is that they institutionalized customary law. Okay, it was before it was tolerated by the state. Okay, right. You had your you had tribal majlises in the past, but it was not recognized by the state. And here, it's not only recognized, but I didn't have time to go into it. But I have one very interesting tribal code prepared by Shes and presented to Faisal a few months before he died, and then resubmitted to the British in 1944, okay, after the reoccupation of Iraq. And there you have one version of tribal law, you may say, which was very favorable to women, relatively favorable, let's put it this way. And the British rejected it, and they said this is not tribal law, okay? So I asked myself, how come this was their, how come they didn't relate to the fact that you have customs here that are different from what they believe them to be? So, first of all, when you look around Iraq and what was going on, Iraq was, tribal law was dynamic, okay? It wasn't old age, it was changing, and it was changing during the time. And you can read into this tribal code the changes in the countryside at the time, okay? Because you see the changes. On the other hand, you have one prominent chef who wrote a book about tribal law, Phil Almondil, if I'm saying it correctly, and he wrote a very harsh version of tribal law concerning women. Okay, so, and this was accepted by some British as full-fledged account of tribal law. Okay, so, the British were not only gave recognition, they sort of, in a way, steer it to be harsh as they believe it was.
Do you think that's a reaction to them, the British trying to maintain tribal autonomy, or is it a way to neuter tribal autonomy?
No, they were all about law and order. It was good.
So classic British tactic. Lord Lugard could tell you all about it in Nigeria, place like that, Simon, and that lady then.
It's Stephen Wagner from Ulster.
Sorry, Stephen.
Yeah. My question's also for Noga. I'm just wondering what's the connection, or whether there's a connection between this institution of tribal law under the British mandate and British commitments to tribal chiefs from before the First World War. So if you look at their negotiations with the Hashemite family during the war, as well as with the French, the one thing they insist on in both of these series of correspondences and talks is that their pre-existing treaties with these chiefs remain in effect no matter what system comes out after the war. And I'm wondering if that's the reason why they're keeping the system.
First of all, I'd like to thank the three speakers for their amazing presentations, but I have a question for Dr. Farah. It's about a point I have seen in your presentation. When you were talking about the clashes between the Druze and the Maronites in 1860, and then you put between brackets Muslim, Christian. And this is very misleading and misunderstood point in the Egyptian press from this time, because I don't know how the Druze define themselves. Are they sect of Muslims, or are they?
It extended to Muslim Christian massacres in Damascus, you know, Abdul Qadir Jazari, Sayyid. So that's what I meant. I didn't mean to say the Druze are Muslim.
Okay.
Under that debate, that's a kind of.
But this debate did really exist because these sects, like the Baha'is and the Druze, were a little confusing because people were used to Muslim Christian Jews, and these religions for them was a little bit not understandable. And because many of them came to Egypt after these clashes, and also the clashes that happened in Jerusalem between the Christians and the Muslims. Many of them, especially the Maronites, when they came to Egypt, they started to show the sense of nationalism, of Arab nationalism they have. And I tend to think that Arab nationalism started with the Levantine Maronites before anyone else, even before the Nazis. And this is at least my view. They just wanted to be integrated in the Egyptian society somehow from Ismail time and onwards. However, when the Druze came to Egypt afterwards, they took this kind of perception, and the Maronites started to be looked at as brother French, while the Druze, and it was emphasized in the 1950s with Kamal Jumblatt and the 1960s, and his relation to Gamal Abdel Nasser and his belief in Nasserism. So I'm not an expert on how the Druze put political adjectives or labels on themselves, but I would like you to tell me when this Ban Arab nationalism thing started with the Druze. Does it have any origins from the late 19th century? Or?
Okay. Noga, do you want to just come back to the scene?
Yeah. So first of all, thank you very much. I would like to know more about the agreements that you encountered and were identified. The truth of the matter is my main concern or main issue of my book was the construction of women as citizens. And now more and more I'm going toward the law and society in Iraq, and I ask why the legal system was the way it was. So the truth of the matter is that I'll be happy to read these agreements. However, I read a lot about the... I read a lot of British accounts, and none of them were saying, we promised, therefore we're keeping our promise, to give them their tribal law. No, the story is that it was either their misunderstanding of Iraqi society, so that was the best way to govern, they thought it was the best way to govern a tribal society, or they, and this is Ireland version, the British came to Iraq, and like in India, where they found a semi-tribalized society or something like this, they decided to reconstruct tribal systems so they can rule through it. Okay, so I'll be very happy.
So would your argument just be they're in a sense trying to forestall modernity, because modernity would bring lots of problems, and it's easier to maintain the traditional tribal society? Sorry, Mark, do you want to
talk? Oh yeah, well it's ironic, maybe you should write a book on this. The Druze actually come from Egypt originally, as you may know. Hakam Yaman Allah and his followers, you know, they flee then to Lebanon. But yeah, of course, the Druze are very prominent Arab nationalists, with Shakib Arslan and before that Atrash, others. So yes, and still today, Walid Jumblatt today, well, he's all over the place.
Not Walid,
but he tended to, for a while, side with Syria and Arab nationalism, even as late as 2004, and was sort of very much defending that. Now, recently, he's defended Jabhat al-Nusra and said they're not a terrorist group, because he wants, I mean, it's still the same strategy that he has, the calculation, do I want to associate with the Sunni majority and save myself that way, because these Jabhat al-Nusra guys are threatening Lebanon right now and my villages, or do I want to cast my lot with the Alliance for Minority Christians and others and Shia, whatever. I And so right now he's in that, and that's always been for the Druze something. Because, I mean, I don't want to get into the religion thing, but that's a bit of a controversy, but it's a religion which is really, you know, not necessarily accepted by, you know, maybe it's the mainstream Sunni Muslims, even though that's, you know, they wear their Arab nationalism on their sleeves. So.
Okay, can I just get two brief questions, because we probably need to conclude soon. Your name, please.
My name is Michael Levin. I'm a PhD candidate at SOAS. My question is for Dr. Efrati. I'm just wondering, sort of at the end of the period of this tribal administration, in 1958, when the regulations revoked or were repudiated, I'm wondering what the discourse of that repudiation is, whether it's that the administration is a legacy of the colonial period, or if it's something that was a block to women's participation in society, and whether it was seen as an anti-feminist regulation that had to be repealed for the new Iraq.
Again, it's a wonderful question, and actually, it was one of women's achievements. Okay, you know, there is a famous movie about women in Iraq made by Maisoor Pachaji, and it starts. The revolution brought many achievements to women. The tribal law was canceled. I'll say what, you know, what's it? But if you see the whole baggage and the fact that, you know, now when you bring back tribal law in Iraq, you have to go back and see what it really meant. And it was one of feminist demand during the 50s to abolish it. And one of the first steps took that the new Republican regime took was to first to abolish the tribal law, and then to abolish Article 41 in the Baghdad Penal Code. Okay, and it was presented as I wouldn't say gift for women because it was a gift for everybody, but it was presented as a revolutionary step.
I have a question from Seda. Actually, two quick questions.
Just say
your name. Oh, sorry, my name is Amy Janelle, and I'm a postdoc at Yale. My first question is about your autonomists, and I wondered what kinds of arguments they made, these pro-autonomy guys, against union. And then my second question is about the legal status of successive waves of Armenians into mandate Syria. And what was their legal status?
Okay, so the Armenians were given citizenship in 1925. By the French, and since then they are considered as Syrian citizens, and they're the first. I mean, although there were other Christian groups, and there were Muslims like Kurds or Circassians also fleeing to Syria, they were not given citizenship as early as the Armenians, which was 1925. And Armenians are, I mean, in addition to the legal status, Armenian community is the only officially recognized community as being non-Arab. The rest of the, I mean, the Syrians, Kurds, and other non-Arab groups are considered as Arab, except the Armenians. That is one thing. And secondly, the arguments of the autonomous groups, and they used to, I mean, there were autonomous in northeastern part of Syria, in the Sanjak of Alexandria, the Alawite region, and the Druze region. Actually, it, I mean, it shows some differences depending on the region. I mean, we can talk more about, but those in northeastern part of Syria, they asked for administrative autonomy, they wanted to have economic autonomy, and they wanted to have, you know, political economy to a certain extent, and they wanted to have the French mandate rule continue, but not terminate. Yet, what is peculiar to the northeastern part, where there was no compact minority, unlike Alawite or Druze or the Sanjak of Alexandria, where there is a Turkish minority, Turkish majority, the northeastern part always underlined the fact that the autonomy movement there is not a sectarian movement. I mean, they, in all of their correspondences and declarations in Arabic, in French, to Vatican, to Brussels, to you know, to Paris, or you know, to Beirut, they argued that their demand is based, it is a territorial demand, but not a sectarian, not a pro-Christian or a pro-Kurdish one, although it oscillated between a pro-Christian and pro-Kurdish one, but they always emphasize, at least officially, that it's a territorial demand. And they derive their demand from, you know, the fact that they are refugees, latecomers to Syria, and because the land is different than the rest of Syria, their languages are different, and so on.
Okay. Thanks very much. We better conclude at that point. Would that be best? Okay. So it just leads me to thank the speakers and the contributors from the audience.